Thank you, Paul. Good afternoon to you all. My name is Gilad Tzuri, as Paul mentioned, and I'm the Vice President of Product Strategy at Lambda Digital Printing. Thank you for inviting me here today to talk in front of this very, very important audience, the most important technical conference for the digital printing. But first, allow me to introduce myself. My background in the printing industry stretches more than 20 years when I started as a mechanical engineer at Indigo working for Benny Landa. After holding few positions at Indigo's R&D, I then moved and served as the HP Indigo Worldwide Service Manager. During my long days and enjoyable years at Indigo, I was privileged to take part in the first digital printing revolution. All that became history when Benny Landa invited me to head Landa's product strategy team and participate again in another historic development. In this presentation today, I'm going to explain why I firmly believe that the innovative Landa printing process we called nanography is the real thing, is the second digital printing revolution. So with no further ado, let's go. In May this year, a Drupa exhibition, the Olympic Games of the printing industry, Landa introduced to the world nanography. There was a tremendous positive reaction in the entire printing industry. Now, I know that some of you or many of you could not attend Drupa, and therefore, I try to bring a bit of Drupa with me today. I will be aided in a part by Benny Landa, who himself could not be here today, but will join us through some video clips. I have been to Drupa 1995, was also known as the digital printing Drupa, when we all believed that the printing industry would become digital. So, has the printing industry become digital? Well, as my colleagues said rightly in Monday's keynote session, there are many printing applications that have become digital, such as photo albums, short-run labels, and transaction printings. And certainly, digital printing has experienced explosive growth, growing from zero when it introduced first in 1993 to a multi-billion dollar industry today, producing over 1 trillion digitally printed pages annually. However, for most part, digital printing has only nibbled around the edge of mainstream printing, with only 2% of all pages being produced digitally. In order to become mainstream, digital printing must be competitive with offset in terms of quality, speed, cost per page, not mentioning format, and most importantly, the ability to print on any kind of standard off-the-shelf paper. This is the reason that 10 years ago at Landa, we developed a new category of printing called nanography, digital printing for the mainstream, to capture the other 98%. As the name implies, nanography is based on nanotechnology, the science of ultra-small particles. Particles so small, in fact, that they are measured in nanometers, billionths of a meter. How small is nanometer? Well, the size of this soccer ball is 200 million nanometers. And our planet Earth is 200 million times bigger than this soccer ball. The reason that nanotechnology has created such a great interest worldwide is that many materials, when reduced in size to nanoparticles, acquire extraordinary properties. Some particles become super hard, able to protect surface from abrasion. Some become super absorbent in the bloodstream, enabling unique drug delivery system. And some, as we discovered at Lambda, these past 10 years become amazingly powerful colorant, enabling entirely new kind of digital printing with incredible attributes. These nanopigments are the heart of the Lambda Nano Ink and impart nanography some remarkable characteristics, including ultra-high-speed digital printing, the industry's broadest color gamut, high optical density images, the sharpest edge dot of any printing process, high gloss and high gloss uniformity, the ability to print on any ordinary untreated paper, stock, coated or uncoated, without any kind of pretreatment, the ability to print practically on any plastic packaging film or label stock, the lowest cost per page, digitally printed page, low energy consumptions, and 100% green. Let's go back to the question of digital printing revolution. I mentioned before that digital printing has captured only 2% of the printing volume, while 98% of the printing remained analog. Why is this? Ladies and gentlemen, to answer this question, we are now going to closely examine today's inkjet process. The industry most used digital printing technology. And who is better to explain this process than Mr. Benny Lambda himself, the father of the digital printing?
Waiting to be digitally printed by inkjet. Though we are sheltered by all these paper fibers around us, they'll be of little protection. For when the dreaded drop hits, it will be like a tsunami, a tidal wave torrent that will drench the paper fibers and will mercilessly drown any nano folks like us. So we'd better get out of here. You see, when printing processes apply ink to paper, the wet ink penetrates the paper. Now, this is true for all printing processes. In the case of inkjet, however, there's so much water in the ink that the paper becomes totally saturated. But paper and water don't mix. The paper gets swollen, deformed, and cockled. The consequence of all that is that you have to heat up all that water and paper to dry it out again. And that consumes a tremendous amount of energy.
You just saw the main reason that aqueous inkjet can be used only for low area coverage applications, such as books and transactional. With the amount of water injected with the ink to the paper, direct to paper inkjet is not suitable for high area coverage applications, applications that are common in all printing segments. Over the last 10 years, we at Landa have developed the Landa Nano Ink. The Nano Ink enables a new kind of printing process we call nanography, the nanographic printing process. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please view the following video clip that describes the Landa nanographic printing process.
Nanographic printing begins with the ejection of billions of microscopic droplets of Landa Nano Ink onto the special image conveyor blanket. Each row of ink ejectors adds its own color of Nano Ink. Each droplet of Nano Ink lands at a precisely designated location, blending with other droplets to create the final colored ink image. As each droplet lands on the heated blanket, it begins to spread and lose its water, becoming thinner as it does so. When all of the water has been evaporated, the ink becomes an ultra-thin, dry, polymeric film. Let's look again. As the Nano Ink film spreads and dries, it becomes only 500 nanometers thick, the thinnest ink image of any printing process. The completed image is now ready to be transferred. Because of its unique properties, Nano Ink images have the amazing ability to bond tenaciously to any paper or plastic without penetrating the substrate. Upon transfer, the Nano Ink film instantaneously bonds to the paper, forming a tough, abrasion-resistant laminated layer, leaving no residual ink on the blanket. Nano Ink images can be transferred to sheets or webs of ordinary coated or uncoated paper or plastic packaging films without any kind of pretreatment. Since Nano Ink images are already dry, there's no need for any kind of post-drying. So two-sided printing becomes simple, and printed goods can be immediately processed right out of the press.
So let me recap. The nanographic printing process itself is a fairly straightforward three-step printing process. The steps are following: ink ejection, ink drying and image formation, image transfer to the substrate. And now, let's take a more detailed look. Nanography starts when billions of nano-sized droplets are ejected from ink ejectors onto a special blanket. And then the nano ink is dried and the image is formed. Lastly, the image is fully transferred from the blanket to the substrate. Fully transferred means no ink residues left on the blanket. And the end results are unique to the printing industry. These unique results deserve a deeper understanding and explanation.
You see, as the ink penetrates the paper, much of the pigment ends up below the surface, reducing optical density and uniformity. And just as ink gets absorbed into the paper fibers, it also wicks along the paper fibers, making the edges ragged. With Landa nanographic printing, a dry ink film is applied to the paper, so there's no penetration and the edges are super sharp. Since these ultra-thin film images are literally laminated to the paper, they conform to its surface roughness right down to the topography of individual paper fibers.
Okay, let's start our tour and talking about the print quality. The principal factors that determine an image quality are mainly derived from the dot attributes and its consistency. Let's compare dots printed using inkjet direct-to-paper printing process with dots printed using nanography. The differences are extremely clear. Inkjet printed dots have irregular shape, blob edges with low optical density. Please note the extraordinary edge sharpness and high image density and uniformity of dots printed using nanography. The differences are even more pronounced when the dots are printed on uncoated paper. Look at the dot shape created by inkjet and compare it with the dot shape created by nanography. Note the difference in the edge ruggedness. In both solid and reverse cases, nanography consistently prints sharper images combined with sharper edges. What is less obvious, but not less significant, is the fact that nanographic solid images are consistently more uniform and have higher optical density than images printed using inkjet. Until now, I have only been comparing nanographic dot shapes to those of inkjet. Let's now see how nanography performs in comparison to other printing processes. These are microscopic photographs of dots printed using mainstream printing processes. No doubt, there are variations between the dots, but they all have one thing in common. All dots have rugged edges. While with nanography, the dots have very sharp and smooth edges. Next, we performed dot roundness and edge ruggedness analysis. The gray area represents the effective image area, while the yellow line represents the printed dot contour. It is clear to see that in non-nanographic cases, the dots have irregular edges. This is true for dots printed on coated and uncoated paper. Nanographic dots are almost perfectly round. An outcome of this analysis is the following chart. This chart compares the edge ruggedness between inkjet and nanography. The x-axis represents the substrate roughness range, while the y-axis represents the relative ruggedness value. The 100 is the ultimate smooth edge dot, and the red and orange line represent inkjet, while London nanography is represented by the light blue line. I believe that the chart is self-evident. In all instances and on all substrate, nanographic dots are significantly sharper and rounder. Now, we compared dots printed with nanography on different substrates. Not only the dots form round and smooth shapes, you can easily see that their size is almost identical whether printed on coated or uncoated paper. But more importantly, lambda dot optical density has the lowest dependency on substrate type. Another important dot attribute is color uniformity. We measure the density across these dots along the marked white lines. The results proves that the density of a dot is more uniform when printed using nanography. All this in comparison to the density of dots printed with other technologies. Better dot uniformity equates to higher quality image. Moreover, it gives greater control over the end results and enables accurate image reproduction. In the following chart, we show the LAB values of the black ink for ISO standard offset printing process. No doubt, this is rightly considered to be a great result. However, because nanography involves nano-sized pigments, the black ink attains uneven deeper black levels. Therefore, with nanography, the dynamic range of black is much wider. This yields wider gray levels and ultimately leads to an extended contrast range. I've demonstrated this phenomenon with the black ink, but it's the same phenomena for the entire nanographic ink set. Because the nano ink pigments are nano-sized, they are excellent absorbents of light. This translates into much broader color gamut. Nanography has very broad color gamut when using the four principal colors, C, M, Y, and K. It is realistically possible to add a mere additional 2-3 colors, and the end result is color gamut that covers almost the entire Pantone range. Another important outcome of nanography ultra-thin film image is the ability to match gloss of paper, whether coated or uncoated. This means that images appear glossy on glossy stock and matte on matte stock, all while maintaining the image qualities. In case of inkjet printing, when printing medium to high area coverage images, there are so much water in the paper so that the paper becomes saturated, swollen, deformed, and crooked. The paper must then be heated until water is evaporated from the paper. This limits the inkjet printing process to low area coverage applications. To truly replace offset, digital presses must be able to print with the same eye coverage as offset. Nanography achieves this. Nanography creates an ink laminate that contains neither water nor other liquids, and therefore nanography preserves the substrate from both water damage and deformation. The substrate remains dry, and since very little heat is applied to the paper surface, it maintains the substrate's original qualities. Another important capability of nanography is its ability to transfer images into substrate without prior need of having specially treated. This capability is a direct result of nanography's three major attributes: the ink layer's high affinity to the substrate, high cohesive forces within the substrate film image, and the blanket ultra-high release properties. Nanography printing process can print on any conventional substrate without pretreatment. Up till now, I talked about the printed results, but what about the cost? Nanographic printing offers the lowest cost per page of all digital printing processes. This is due to a variety of aspects. First, low-cost substrate. The ability to print on any kind of off-the-shelf substrate offers commercial printers the economic freedom of being able to print on low-cost paper. Second is the ink carrier. Lambda Nano ink is water-based ink, and water is the cheapest ink carrier. Next is the image thickness. The Lambda Nanographic printing process creates a film of about 500 nanometers, approximately half the thickness of an offset printed image. Therefore, nanography uses less ink to print the same image. And finally, energy consumption. With other printing processes, a major part of the energy consumed is used for heating paper, as this is the only way available for evaporating the ink carrier. Nanography is more energy efficient. Nano ink drying is done while the ink is on the blanket, and therefore almost no heat applied to the paper. Because of all these advantages, nano ink and nanographic printing can be applied across a broad spectrum of applications, opening up great new potentials for digital printing. In other words, nanography is the technology that enables digital printing for mainstream applications. Ladies and gentlemen, now that we have seen how nanography works, it is my pleasure to briefly introduce you to the Lambda Nanographic printing presses. The family of Lambda Nanographic printing presses comprise three sheet-fed machines, three web presses spanning the entire range of commercial printing, packaging, and publishing application. Let me introduce you to one family member, the Lambda W50 Nanographic printing press. Thank you. So let me summarize. Nanography is different in four distinct areas from any other printing process. Nanography is using water-based nanopigment ink, and therefore it is low cost, low energy, and green printing process. No subset wetting, and therefore no paper heating or paper distortion. No ink penetration into the paper, and the results are sharper dots and the widest color gamut in the printing industry. And very importantly, the lowest cost per page digital printed images. My dear colleagues, I've been heavily involved in the printing industry for almost 25 years. I took part in the first digital printing revolution, and I'm convinced we are entering an era in which nanography will enable digital printing to be used for mainstream applications. I truly believe we are witnessing the second digital printing revolution, the dawning of a new era for the printing industry. I thank you very much for your attention and for listening. Thank you very much. We need some mic, right?
Yeah. Thank you, Gilad, for a most interesting insight. And I'd like to invite any questions, if there are any. Could you use the microphone, please?
That was a very interesting marketing presentation. Can I just ask a couple of scientific questions? I didn't mean it to be meant in any. First of all, you showed in one of your slides your drop size is about 50 to 70 nanometers, which means that your pigments must be very, very small. So the first question is, how do you make those very small pigments? It must be costly. Secondly, you still have to drive the water off the blanket, so the energy cost must be similar to conventional inkjet printing. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. So first, for the first point, the drop size is not what you said. The drop size is much bigger. The pigment size is, as you mentioned, is about 40 to 80 nanometers. The drop size is much bigger. As for the energy requires to evaporate the water is the same. The difference is that while doing it in the paper, you also need to warm up the paper significantly, and therefore you're wasting quite a lot of energy for this sense.
Hello, I'm Pramod Sharma from Lexmark International, and this is very amazing press on new technology. But I have a question. I have a lot of interest in image transfer in general. So how do you transfer 100% image of 100% of the time from the ITM or blanket?
Again, can you repeat the question?
How do you achieve 100% transfer? I hear there is no cleaner in this press from the ITM.
So I think the question is, how do you achieve 100% transfer of the ink from the blanket to the paper?
So it's a combination of three main attributes. First, when the ink layer is dry and hot, it is very sticky. It is very tacky to substrate, and therefore this is one aspect that really affects. The second aspect, since the ink layer is very, very thin, there is high cohesive forces within the ink layer, and therefore there is no split within the ink layer. And third, we have a special release properties to the blanket that creates very easy transfer of the image from the blanket to the substrate.
Okay, thank you.
Koji Hirakula, Hilux Consulting. Thank you very much for your very nice video presentation and very nice slide. But last May, I flew from Tokyo to Düsseldorf and joined Landa's theater. But today's, your presentation, there was no news and technical issues. This conference is not commercial conference. You should more present scientific or technological issues of your technology. I would like to hear that surface properties of intermediate transfer belt and chemistry of that nano ink.
Sorry, the question?
Yeah. My question is surface properties of intermediate transfer belt and the rough chemical structure of the nano ink.
I think the question was, could you describe the surface properties of the blanket?
I will not be able to get in the surface properties of the blanket. This is part of the proprietary data of Landa, and we will not be able to describe this in details.
Thank you.
I second his comment. This is Dan Fleming, Western Michigan University. I second his comments, but I do have some other technical questions. How are your drops formed and then ejected to the substrate?
Again?
Or to the blanket.
I was.
So I think the question is, how are the drops formed and how are they transferred to the blanket?
So the drops are formed inside of ink ejectors. Ink ejectors is based on inkjet heads that we are doing modification to fit to the Landa nanography printing process.
Okay, so you're doing inkjet printing to an intermediate carrier, then directly to the substrate. Now, if this intermediate character is so easy to transfer the ink to the substrate, how do you control the formation on this highly, probably low surface energy blanket and still get your drops to land where they may and stay where you want them to?
The blanket itself contains few attributes or few properties. One of the properties of the blanket is the ability to maintain the drops in its fine location and create the exact image size of the drop.
So you can hold them when you want to hold them, and you can release them when you want to release them.
Exactly.
That's the magic. And then finally, another question. Once you've laid your mostly dried ink onto the substrate, is it going to be easier or harder to de-ink than conventional inkjet?
So regarding the inking, we are now working with few paper mills to evaluate exactly our inking capabilities. It is too early for me to say the exact results. We are looking into that. Probably in the coming months, we'll be more educated on that and be able to say where exactly are we standing, comparing to other technologies, offset, inkjet, and other technologies.
Thank you.
We have time for just two more questions. Thank you.
Yes, Gary Ellis from Flint Group Pigments. I actually do have two questions that are related.
Let's roll them into one.
Okay, the first is, are the pigments conventional pigment classes like thalocyanine, a yellow, pigment yellow 74, or are you using what we would consider to be unconventional pigments?
I will not be able to get to the details of the exact pigments, but I do want to say that we are striving to work with conventional pigments. This is, we would like to strive to work as much as close to the most conventional printing processes and replace offset.
Okay. And the second question, which again probably is proprietary, but pigments tend to form agglomerates very, very easily. And I just wondered if the pigment makers are able to prevent the agglomeration when they actually strike or form the pigment, or if you're doing all of your reduction by milling and stabilizing the dispersion.
Again, repeat the question.
Pigments tend to aggregate or agglomerate together, and I wondered if the pigment makers you're working with, or if your company is actually making the pigments, if you're able to prevent those aggregates from ever forming, or are you simply reducing your particles down to the nano size strictly by milling technology?
The milling process and the grinding process of our ink is probably the biggest trade secret of Landa, and therefore, unfortunately, I cannot share with you this kind of information.
Okay. I sort of expected that would be the case. Thank you.
All right.
And we have time for one final question.
So I just have very simple questions. What's the lifetime of your belt by still keeps all the characteristic and the property of your belt? How much what's the lifetime? How long your belt can last? How many cycles or times or days, you know?
It's too early for us to give the exact numbers as we are testing right now the lifespan of the blankets. But I do want to say that we're expecting millions of pages coming of each blanket.
Okay.
Thank you. And can we thank our speaker one more time? Thank you.